Hey everyone, in today's video, I'm putting Burp AI to the test, but not in the way it was intended. I'm going to unleash Burp AI against some CTF challenges. Now, it wasn't built to solve CTF challenges, so this is absolutely the wrong way to use it, but that's what makes it fun. If you haven't already seen my earlier video where I break down what Burp AI actually is and how it works, make sure to check that one out. First, I'll link it in the video description. But if you're up for an adventure, let's see if Burp AI can find some solutions to various web challenges. Okay, so the Hacking Hub room we are going to try is Remote Binge. And I have the room booted up. You'll see we have the scope here. I have added that to Burp Suite. We have Burp AI enabled. Let's actually visit the site. So I'm going to open the browser. Let's paste it in. And here we go. Let's try using agentic mode first. So what I'm going to do is send this get request here. This just get request to the website's root to repeater. Then I guess we can just say, actually, you know what? I'll send it so that we have the response here. Hack the application to discover a flag. So it doesn't give us any information about that. Once you perform remote commands on the server, you'll be able to recover the contents of the flag. So we basically have to hack this application somehow. Doesn't give any clues, which is actually good. But hey, why don't we just say to Burp AI, can you find any vulnerabilities in this application? Let's start off with a simple query and see how it goes. So we're going to go to the task. So Burp Repeater's agentic mode has created this task with our initial prompt, and it's going to go off and hopefully explore. So I'll start by exploring the main page to understand the application structure and functionality. The response shows an action wanted badge creator application that accepts email and file uploads via post form. Okay, yep, there's an email and a file. File upload application, which is often a vector for vulnerabilities, correct. I need to understand how the application processes uploads and what validations it put in place. I'll first examine the base request to establish baseline behavior and look for any additional endpoints or functionality. The initial get request confirms the application structure. Okay, it's a badge creator with a file upload form. Fully explore the application structure. So it's going to do directory enumeration. Okay, so what do these requests look like? Get placeholder. Okay, so it looks like almost everything is coming back as a 200. Apart from when you give it a .php, it comes back with a 404. So that's interesting. So it hasn't detected that all these endpoints are giving 200s. So you'll notice the length of all these pages is 3,478. And it looks like the API one, I guess, is there because it didn't have. Okay, so I take back that statement. It did notice something different, which was all of these came back with a 200 status code, 200 okay, and a length of 3,478. But the API didn't come back with a length, so it's a blank. So it did actually technically find one. Probably should have just kept reading, to be honest. That's a failure on my part. Intruder scan revealed an interesting finding. API endpoint, blah, blah, blah. Okay, scroll down. Enumerate API endpoints and methods. The API endpoint returns a 200 okay, but with empty content. Okay, so it's going to try and fuzz all these. Again, we're getting 3478s. Did it find anything? No. All tested API paths return the main page. So it's now going to use the file upload. It's going to test a GIF file upload. And what was the response? Your badge is ready. Okay, I think I skipped ahead. So it uploaded something here. Okay, uploaded a test.txt file. Tried to upload a test.txt file, and it got, yes, invalid file type. Only image GIF files are allowed. So it's testing that. The GIF upload was successful. The application processed the file and stored it, making it web accessible. This is a major security finding. Uploaded files are directory accessible via URL, which could be exploited if I can add upload malicious content disguised as GIF files. Okay. Test PHP code injection in GIF. So it's going to upload that. So it's going to basically, let's have a look. It's going to call it malicious.gif. It's going to give it a GIF header, and then it's just going to put PHP code in there. So now it's going to try and access it. The PHP code did not execute. So if we look at this request again, it literally just, yeah, spits back the PHP code. Test a PHP extension a bypass. So it knows that it can upload GIFs. It's going to try and upload and say it's a GIF file, but also add .php on the end. It's also calling it a GIF in the content type. The double extension was accepted. Okay. So now if we expand this, It looks like if we render it, right, are we actually getting anything? We do. We get system information. Okay, that's cool. So it actually did. So excellent. The application accepted the double extension file name test.gif.php and uploaded it successfully. And then it literally visited it. So we could actually, if we right click, send to repeater. Nice. Cool. Let's go back because the task requires us to grab the contents of the flag, which is from /flag.txt. So I wonder if I can do something like explain, go back to this file upload. Let's do, so this is what worked. So I'm going to send this to repeater and we're going to go to Burp AI and we don't actually need the response here. We can just say, okay, we're going to, I'll just explain what the vulnerability is, I guess. So maybe I should go back to the dashboard and see, maybe I'll just give it its own little summary. So let's copy that, Burp AI. And then what we'll do is we'll say, can you exploit this vulnerability and grab the contents of the /flag.txt file from the server. So basically, I've given it its own description of what it found with this request. And let's send that and see what happens. It's going to create a new task. And hopefully what it'll do is it's going to create a new payload that's going to contain some code that does remote command execution and then grab the file. Let's see what happens. Okay, so it's going to confirm the vulnerability exists. By disguising a file, and it basically did the exact same thing. It uploaded successfully. That's great. So I actually went and grabbed it. Upload PHP file to read flag. The vulnerability is fully confirmed. This proves double extension bypass works, and the server executes PHP files in the API /temp directory, giving us remote code execution capability. So now I need to exploit this to read the /flag.txt. I'll upload a new PHP file that uses file get contents to read the flag directly. Okay, the second PHP file was uploaded. Did it actually access it? Looks like it stopped, but I'm guessing we can just run this ourselves, right? So go to repeater. Nice. Obviously, it's going to output the header as well. So we're going to copy that. We're going to go back here and we're going to paste it in. Nice. All right. I mean, that wasn't too difficult. So we'll rate that as easy, definitely easy. And Burp AI, it took Burp AI 2 attempts, but honestly, it kind of got it with the first attempt here. And I didn't really ask it. I didn't give it a prompt at the start to actually exploit the application. I wasn't looking for anything. So next time, what I'll do is be more explicit about what I want. Because even in this case, like I did ask for the contents and it sort of went there. But then it didn't. Oh, actually, it did run a request, but it didn't print it. So sometimes it'll like run a task summary. Oh, okay. Should probably read the task summary, right? I guess I just skipped ahead. I thought it was maybe going to say something down here about what the flag was, but it turns out this was like a preamble, and then the response was here. But the task summary actually does have the flag. Cool. So we're going to see how Burp AI fares against some Portswigger Web Academy labs. We're going to start off with this exploiting XXE to perform SSRF attacks. It's an apprentice level lab. If it's any good at this, we will, try something a little more complicated. But this lab has a check stock feature, parses XML input, returns any unexpected values. Lab server is running on a simulated EC2 metadata endpoint at default URL, which is this. Endpoint can be used to retrieve data about the instance. Some of it might be sensitive. So what we're going to do, we're going to start this lab. We're not going to tell it anything about the application. We're just going to see if it can find any interesting vulnerabilities. But first, you might notice, if I boot this lab up, we do get a lovely, helpful message at the top. And in fact, in the title, if I view page source, title, exploiting XXE to perform SSRF attack. So we need to remove those. And the way I'm removing them, I have Burp Pro, which has Burp AI. I have an upstream proxy, which I'm going to proxy all WebSecurityAcademy.net traffic to port 8081. What's running on port 8081? Another instance of Burp Suite, this time Burp Suite Community Edition. And I've just got a few match and replace rules. We remove the header, remove the title. Technically, we just replace it with no title. And then we're going to strip out the banner, the Academy Lab header, and then also this lab header.js reference. The upshot of which is if I copy this, so this is in my regular Firefox browser, and you can see nothing's being proxied here. If I go to Chromium, which is using Burp Suite Pro, which is proxied through Burp Suite Community Edition. If I visit the lab here, this is what we see. So basically, this entire section is gone, and the title is now no title. We go here, send to repeater, click send, so we get a response. You can see no title there. Everything is working. This is basically where that the header was before, the banner. So we get a response, so we can actually tell Burp AI, hey, here's a request and response for context. Let's say, are there any vulnerabilities in this application. Let's see how it does with that. So we have a task. Burp AI is going to hopefully explore the application. Now, it doesn't have much functionality. So this, it sometimes there's like a My Account, like a login page. There isn't here. So effectively, all we really have is this view details, which has a product ID. So it might try SQL injection up here. It also has this check stock feature. And this is where the vulnerability actually is. It's going to explore the application's functionality to identify potential vulnerabilities. It's going to examine the first product page to understand how the application handles user input and processes product IDs. Exactly what I suggested. It was going to try SQL injection, parameter tampering, insecure direct object references, starting with a valid product ID. Okay, so it is literally just giving it a bunch of IDs, and it gets 404s, 400s, so nothing. So it suggests the application has input validation, but I need to test if this validation can be bypassed or if any other injection points exist. So now it's going to explore the stock check functionality. This post endpoint accepts both product ID and store parameters and likely performs backend operations to check inventory. This is a prime target for vulnerabilities like SQL injection, XXE if it processes XML, or other injection attacks. Let's see. Critical discovery. The stock check functionality expects XML input, not form data. It got a bad request, XML parser exited with error. So actually, it used the error message here to determine that it wanted XML. Stock check functionality returned an XML parser error, which is a strong indicator of an XXE vulnerability. The error message, content is not allowed in prolog, suggests the application expects XML input, but received form data. I need to examine the XML stock check payload.js file to understand how the application constructs XML requests. Okay, that's good. Perfect. I found the XML payload structure by examining. So it examined this JavaScript file to determine what the payload looks like. And it looks like it's going to try and send this payload. Yep. So it determined this is what the payload is supposed to look like. The response it got was a 200 OK with 163. So now it's going to test for XXE. Okay. So it actually, for some reason, stopped. But we can just send this to repeater and, oh, hang on. Did it find it? What did this task summary say? It's interesting because it sort of doesn't. So it did actually find it. It did actually exploit it, which is good. But then it sort of just stopped. It didn't say anything else. So I guess one thing to make sure you do is always read the task summary, because it says it successfully identified and exploited a critical XXE and retrieved the complete contents of Etsy password. It didn't look like it did that until you actually check the response down here. So I'm glad I checked the response. So it did actually find something. That's useful. But we want to grab the EC2 metadata endpoint. So what we can do now is send this request to repeater, use Burp AI. You found this XXE vulnerability. Can you try, you know what? I'm not even going to give it the EC2. I'm going to say, can you try and find any backend server information? Let's see if that does anything, because it's already found the XXE, which is good. I just want to see if it will actually try, because obviously the EC2 metadata endpoint is a pretty common URL. So maybe it's going to try files first. I don't know. But it also might try, well, I'm hoping it's going to try URLs. Gathering backend system information. So it is going to try all of these. And it looks like it is finding stuff, right? So these 400 status codes are expected, right? So the 400 bad request still contains the information. So it has found a ton of information here. I wonder if it's going to try and find anything else. I may have been a little bit too careful. Maybe backend cloud information. You know what? Let's do that. Backend cloud environment information. Let's do this. It's grabbed the MySQL data. So it did grab quite a lot, but I really want to find cloud environment metadata. Okay, here we go. So it, hopefully, fingers crossed, this will actually do something. So what's it trying now? Okay, so it's still trying to find metadata that's on the host. Ah, here we go. Testing AWS metadata service. So it's determined this is an Amazon EC2 T3 small instance. Oh, okay. So it found this. Hang on. That's interesting. So which one was that? The sysclass. This one? I think this one. Center repeater. That's good. Okay. So it found this, and I imagine product name. This one chose t3.small. Okay, cool. That's interesting. Okay, it tried accessing the metadata endpoint directly. That's just not going to work. Is it going to try it in here? Yes. And the response. Excellent. Okay, so it did do this. So great success. XXE vulnerability can indeed make HTTP requests to the AWS instance metadata service. Check IAM security credentials. Okay, so this should be what we're looking for here. IAM security credentials, admin role credentials. And there we go. Okay, and if we go back here, yep, lab is solved. Nice. Okay, so that did take a few prompts, but so it did find the vulnerability. The lesson is always check the task summary, and maybe I'll report this to Portswigger and be like, hey, it'd be nice to have like a final response that says, you know, something. But this did technically have the response here, right? So it found the XXC the first run, and then I'm going to put this down to me just saying, hey, backend server information. I was probably asking for a bit too much there. But this prompt, backend cloud environment information, not only did it go and find files related to cloud configuration, but then it went and tried to find the metadata API. So we actually got quite a lot of information from this, and it even found the role credentials all by itself. Look at that. Nice. If you enjoyed this experiment, don't forget to hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, and drop a comment below. I'd love to hear what other kind of things you think I should use Burp AI on. Until next time, happy hacking.